Oh shit, it's Mind Pump time! It's exciting to be here with Mind Pump. Did I just scare everybody? I scared Doug. I hope we have a camera on Doug. He literally lost his mind just now because I screamed into the mic. Anyhow, we got a great giveaway for you today. As usual, one of you lucky people is going to win a free access to MAPS Anabolic, the foundational MAPS workout program. Great for strength, great for muscle building. Here's how you can win. In the comments below, leave a good comment. It's got to be done in the first 24 hours that we drop this episode. So get in there right now. Subscribe to this channel. Turn on your notifications. If we pick your comment, if we like your comment, we'll let you know. And you'll get free access to MAPS Anabolic. One more thing before we start the show. MAPS Strong and MAPS Powerlift are both 50% off. This is a huge promotion. Go check them out. Head over to mapsfitnessproducts.com. Just use the code AUGUSTSPECIAL with no space for that discount. All right, here comes the show. There's that page on Instagram that show. I don't know what it's called. Nature is Metal, or it's one of those pages.
I love that page.
Did you see the one? They were on a safari. They're in a Jeep, and the giraffe started charging them, and the dude in the Jeep, the driver, booked it, and the giraffe was on their ass, dude. Like, the woman in the back is freaking out because they ran fast.
How fast do you think the over 40?
If you just saw the giraffe running, you think it was going hella slow. Because it's like, but it's booking, dude.
We'll think about long the distance legs. They cover.
Yeah. We should look that up. We should look up the speed of a giraffe.
Let's have some guesses. I'm going to guess.
I think top speed, 45 35. Miles an hour.
Oh, wow. I think 21.
No way, dude.
Yeah.
No.
21 40, miles.
At least 40 miles an hour.
40?
Yeah. At least.
That's
37.
Oh! See, close. I said 35, so...
Oh, Justin went.
I went over. Isn't that the rules in the games or whatever?
That's right.
Price is right.
Yeah. The price is right.
So, yeah. Justin is the winner.
I bid $1.
Ding, 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 ding.
Whatever. It's fast.
That is pretty quick,
that's
actually.
That's crazy, though.
Big-ass lanky legs and shit.
Because, like, a cheetah's like 60, right?
That's 80.
Like
50 to 80.
80 for a cheetah.
A hippo can go 30.
A hippo can go 30.
You know, I like watching fat-ass them fight hippo. Each other.
Who, giraffes?
Their huge necks, they just slam into each other.
They swing their heads at each other.
I don't think I've ever seen that.
Giraffes look weak, but they're gangster. They really get hunted. You know that? by lions. When they're full-grown, nobody messes with them.
You'd be a big giraffe guy.
Huh?
Yeah. They'd be a big giraffe.
You think they whip
you and all your
head?
Zoo friends.
They're just big, dude. Yeah. Like, how's a lion going to get a giraffe?
Yeah, they sort of try and climb up them and then give up.
Huh? And they get kicked by their big ass legs.
Yeah.
Do lions try and take them down?
I'm sure.
I've seen videos, but the full-grown giraffes, nobody really touches them at all. But the king of the jungle, Doug actually named it, is not the lion.
It's the hippo.
Hippo.
Yeah. I do know
every
that.
Animal scared
it kills
of the hippo.
The most humans every year.
Have you seen videos of hippos messing up lions?
I have seen them.
And giraffes? I saw one snap a giraffe in half. I mean, not a giraffe, a crocodile in half.
Oh, yeah.
Like, just with this big-ass mouth.
Yeah, I think you've brought, maybe on the show before, where you brought up the power of their jaw. I think
they're aggressive. Like, the males are super aggressive. If you're near where
they're like dicks, aren't they?
They'll attack you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they'll run out of the water. But they look like big, fat, cute, you know, animals, but they're not, you know?
I saw the... I think it's Dr. Huberman, I believe. I know.
Oh, he talked about that study.
Yeah, he brought up the study that you brought up.
Dude, that study is flying right now because...
Well, it's a big deal. I mean, for the longest time, we've talked about this, and the pushback that we used to get was that the research that we did have out there did not confirm this, you know, 30 to 50 calories per pound of muscle that we used to tout.
Yes.
And the debate we always made was, well, that's because there's other factors that we're unaware of or we haven't been able to exactly pinpoint.
Yes, and we've observed this in clients.
Right.
Like, I've had clients gain 3 pounds of muscle and their metabolism is 700 calories faster, right? It doesn't equate to what we would think each pound burns, but there's other stuff going on. So in this study, and I talked about it a little bit in a previous episode, but in this study, it was observed both in animals and humans. Okay, so here's what happens, right? When muscles were under heavy resistance training, so just like lifting weights, they actually create these, they're almost like bubbles or vesicles are called, that leave the muscle and transport a type of RNA, which is like a single strand DNA.
RNA or whatever.
And it floats over to fat. And then what it does is it actually tells the genes in the fat to behave differently. So what it tells the fat to do is to literally become more metabolically active. So it moves to the fat and you end up burning more fat at the same calorie deficit. Literally teaching your body, in essence, we need to burn more body fat. And it's probably because muscle is metabolically active. You want to be strong. It's probably advantageous mm-hmm. at that point. So it's not, oh, I built more muscle, I have a fast. It's immediate. You lift weights and you automatically prime your fat to burn more, which is remarkable. And they now know this mechanism that it's a part of it.
Do you know what led to the research? Like, do we have like a new tool or a new way of measuring something right. that now allowed us to unpack, figure this out?
No, I think it's more, so here's what they did with the mice from what I remember. To simulate resistance training in mice, I think they paralyzed one leg, so the other leg has to do double the work. And then in humans, they obviously had them lift weights. I think what it is that resistance training or strength training had very little studies not that long ago. Like, nobody studied it for this kind of stuff. They only studied it for performance, mm-hmm. but now they're studying it for health, fat loss, diabetes, insulin resistance. And so far, every study is showing resistance training kicks the crap out of all other forms of exercise. It's across the board. Mm-hmm. It's the most effective. But this is a great fat loss one because it's not, oh, you're okay, you built more muscle, you speed up your metabolism, blah, 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 blah. It's literally changing the way your genes act. Mm-hmm. In other words, it's making your fat more likely to burn, yeah. which is remarkable.
Yeah, that's true. It's
on a whole new mechanism that yes. we didn't know about.
Yes. Speaking of studies, whenever I read a study, I start to kind of go down like a wormhole. And for some reason, I ended up on testosterone. I think it's because we had the episode with Dr. Rand.
Oh, yeah.
So that's in the back of my mind, right? So like testosterone, its effects, what it does, whatever. So I found a bunch of studies that connect high testosterone to success in men. So not just like more muscle, better health, better vitality, sex appeal, blah, blah, blah. Literally higher testosterone levels connected to more success in business, make more money, better. How crazy is that?
I mean, it's not that crazy. It's pretty obvious when you think about it. I mean, it's you can show the connection to that with probably getting better sleep and better relationships. Like if mm-hmm. you're a better, happier human being, I would imagine that translates into more success financially in life.
Well,
too.
In particular, it's the drive that they say. It increases yeah. drive and ambition.
And even more so.
You know, let me ask you this, because you're the perfect person to ask, because you were on high doses of testosterone when you competed. You went off low testosterone for a while.
Yeah.
Tried to get it to go normal for a while. Didn't necessarily work. Then you worked with, now you're working with Dr. Rand, and they have you on TRT. So now your testosterone's high again.
Yeah.
Besides muscle, besides all that stuff, did you notice a change in your drive going low and going up?
Like, oh, yeah. Okay. I the things that I'm enjoying or feel good the most is just improved mood and sense of just energy throughout the day. Like, that was one of the things I was noticing I was having a really hard time with was this dip. I didn't have the same motivation to go in the gym and lift weights. I didn't have the same motivation to drive and work and things we're doing. It was just this very, very low level all the time. And I had these very small windows of when I'd feel like good, where I feel consistently good again. And that's the biggest thing that I noticed from that, which obviously will... I'm more productive at work. I'm more consistent with my workouts. And
it's connected to confidence in both men and women. Yeah, so the feeling of, feeling confident, wanting to put yourself out there.
And you got
to
think there's like a feedback loop to that too, right? So you feel confident, you have good energy levels. So then you go exercise, you lift weights.
Feeling better.
You build muscle, you lose body fat, you look mm-hmm. better, you feel even more better again. So you got to think the reason why I think they can point to that is because there's multiple factors that are contributing to, you know, and that's what I meant by the success with the money thing. It's mm-hmm. like if you lined up all those things, right? Someone who is fitter, stronger, more right. energy, sleeping better. Yeah. I mean, all those things. Like, do you think
they're
going to
tackle more difficult challenges? Yeah. You know, they're going to pursue yeah. more risky type of
harder
adventures.
Shit's less hard now. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like you look at. I mean, he even alluded to that in the conversation, right? Where he's talking about just. You know, when you're just down and you're sick and you're tired, like everything looks terrible. The world's coming to an end.
Your filter's different.
Yeah, your filter's different. Whereas mm-hmm. when you feel strong and capable and you have energy and you feel good, like, you know, the tasks that you have to accomplish, they look different.
So yeah. from my experience in the past and from people I've talked to who've done this, the difference is not subtle. It's night and day.
Yeah, it's night and day.
It's like a different, completely yeah. different.
Especially in my case, because I went so high, you got to think that for 5 years or so, or close to 5 years, I think 4 or 5 years that I was consistently using anabolics, you know, I was used to that feeling of feeling superhuman and amazing all the time and just invincible. And then to come off, to have that massive dip. And then even after, the, I think it was, I went almost 3 years, right? It was close to 3 years, I think, we were working at trying to get my testosterone up naturally. You know, I had moments during that time of, oh, I'm feeling better, you know, because everything lined up perfect, you know, and so I felt a little bit better for maybe a day or two. But, you know, it was a battle. Now, just simply being on a mild therapeutic dose like that, like instantly. I mean, instantly I felt that within 2 days.
You know, what's funny about this is that testosterone does the same things for women that it does for men. It's just much, much lower dose.
Yeah.
Because I did get some messages from women who heard the episode and they're like, you know, what about us? Like what?
Right.
You know, and it's women, same thing. Now, the difference is, whereas they might give a man 200 milligrams of testosterone a week, for example, for a woman, it would be more like 15 or 20 milligrams. Women are far more sensitive to it. Mm-hmm. But the same thing, confidence, libido, you know, it reduces anxiety, energy. It's the same exact stuff that men will feel, women will feel as well. It's just a much, much, much lower dose. Because I know the women were DMing me, they're like, but am I going to grow a beard? Like, what's going to happen? It's like, no, no, no. They'll keep you within your range. Mm-hmm. They'll just keep you at the higher end of that range and you'll feel the same effects.
Didn't he say too, there was like this 6 month sort of reversal of any of the side effects that, you know, if you were to kind of like go past, you know, the amount, that there was still like a 6 month sort of window.
Yeah. There's nothing. Testosterone's an incredibly safe hormone in comparison to other hormones that you could take exogenously. Like, so imagine if you had insulin, estrogen, growth hormone, thyroid hormone, and testosterone. And someone said, I'll pay you $1 million to take 10 times your normal amount or 100 times your normal amount of one of these. Which one do you pick? Testosterone.
Yeah.
It's not going to do anything. It's not going to hurt you. You're going to be totally fine. All the other ones, well, insulin will kill you.
Yeah.
Thyroid would probably kill you at that much. Growth hormone could probably cause some issues as well. Testosterone won't. So it's a very safe hormone. But for the women, it's the conversion of testosterone to DHT that can sometimes cause problems. And he said that's easily controlled with medication.
Well, so, and also too, it's very much managed.
That's what
by
I mean.
Professionals. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
so that's why I'm so glad that we're finally partnered with somebody. I mean, we've been working on this for a while because it's one of the number one questions that I get in my DMs. And I'm just not qualified to be guiding people in hormone replacement, both men and women, you know. And I was blown away, I remember, I've said this many times now on the show, I cannot believe how many young men suffer from the low testosterone.
Oh, so I think this is going to be it's already a huge market.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be one of the biggest markets, mainly because of the decline. And it's still a mystery. We have guesses as to why testosterone levels have been declining now for 5 decades consistently. But it's a problem. And until we can figure out what the hell is going on, which it's probably a lot of factors, you're going to see a lot of men who are going to need to replace testosterone because it's bad for your health. And you feel
it's
like
funny
shit.
Because it's been, you know, this has been widely accepted and popular in the like celebrity community.
Yeah, sort of elite group.
Oh, yeah, they've been doing it for a while.
Yes. Yeah, but it just used to be very...
It was inaccessible to your average person.
I remember when Katrina and I first started dating, like her mom, they're connected to some like celebrity doctor. And I mean, they've been doing that for like 30 plus years.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's been around for a long time. It's just been, it's been so taboo, and everybody connects like testosterone or anabolics to bodybuild steroid guys. Mm-hmm. And you know, you're talking about like Katrina's mom who's in her 60s. You know what I'm saying? That's not why they...
It's a big difference.
Yeah. It's balancing out your hormones. And I remember when we first met, I remember Katrina, we were just before 30 years old, and her mom was like, I want you to make sure, she made her go down and get all of her hormone levels tested to see where she was at when she felt optimal, because she's like, one day you'll be my age and those levels are going to change and you're going to want to know where your baseline was. So I recommend that to anybody who's listening right now, even if you think your hormones are good and balanced, to go get your blood work
done. So you know what your normal...
So you know what normal is. So even if you don't think you're a candidate for somebody who hormone replacement therapy will be good for, if you feel great already, well, go find out what great is. Because that's the thing that I've learned through this whole journey, is that all these arbitrary numbers that you've heard thrown around, I've heard for so long.
It's very individual.
What's high? Yeah, it's very individual, and it's really based off of you. And so if you're listening and you feel really good, well, go find out what that looks like so that you have a reference point in 5, 10, 20 years down the road. When you're not feeling as good, yeah, a doctor knows what he's aiming for to get you back to feeling that way.
Yeah, and here's the other thing too. Off air, I talked to Doc because he runs a clinic and they work with much more than just testosterone, right? They work with other hormones and they work with certain peptides that, and this is all doctor supervised. I asked them questions about the peptides because I didn't know a whole lot about them. But apparently there are peptides that are pretty well studied. Again, this is all under doctor supervision, that will naturally do things like increase your growth hormone levels. Now, not to the levels of where you're going to get if you took growth hormone outside, you know, exogenously, but naturally raising growth hormone, and they're seeing positive benefits from that as well. So really interesting stuff.
Yeah.
And the reason why I'm really happy about this is because we, look, people don't know this. We talk to a lot of these clinics because mm-hmm. we constantly get DMs from especially young men who are like, what do I do? I need help. And we don't want to give, like you said, Adam, we're not qualified to give recommendations. We'd love a place to, I learned this as a trainer. One thing that I learned as a trainer that made me very valuable was I had connections to people that I trusted that were experts in things that I was not experts in, an expert in. I had chiropractors that I trusted that were really good. Mm-hmm. I had physical therapists. I had acupuncturists and gut health doctors. And so when I had a client come to me with an issue, I would say, look, I don't know, but I know somebody that I trust. Yeah, and and it would bring so much value. We finally have somebody that's really good in this field because I was not impressed with some of the other people.
Oh, I know. And I wish I could think of a few of my clients that we've been through a long journey of troubleshooting and doing just about every specific type of elimination diet and, different types of training modalities. And this really motivated me to go get more educated in a lot of different directions. But I was always looking for a good hormone doctor.
Oh, I sent the episode to so many friends and family already.
Yeah,
because I have uncles and family and aunts and family members that have asked me like hormone questions for so long, and like I can give them very surface answers, and I'm like, I'm just not the person to.
Yeah.
I'm learning still. I mean, I'm still learning through this whole process myself, and but I do know what a world of a difference it's made for me personally, and so glad that we found him.
Now, speaking of more fitness studies, I read another really interesting one on children. So they found in the study that when they had children exercise, it improved their vocabulary and it improved their ability to learn and apply new vocabulary.
Well, that's very obvious to me because of what I just learned about. I don't know if I shared this on the show. I know I told you guys off air the whole speech therapy thing that we had Max go do. Did I talk about that on the show, Doug? Do you know if I talked about that?
I don't think you did.
No. You just talked about him potentially going to Montessori.
Of course, every parent, anytime your kid is potentially slightly behind in anything, you start worrying and freaking out.
Of course,
researching, Googling like crazy, like what month should he be saying three words together and all of that. So, anyways, Katrina hired a speech therapist to meet with Max, and she basically kind of laughed at us and said he is just fine and. He's, don't worry. She goes, the thing that we look for when we're helping these kids who are behind on speaking, she goes, is their ability to understand. Like if they're not speaking and they don't look like they're comprehending or understanding what you're trying to communicate to them.
That makes sense.
Then we're more concerned. If they're just not speaking yet, because maybe they haven't been socially acting or interacting with other kids very often. We just had COVID go on, but you can clearly see they understand what you're communicating to them. It's just, she's like, kids like that, they end up saying a bunch. Anyways, point of bringing this up and to your point with the study was one of the things that we could have done better. And looking back now, right, if we have a second kid, what we'll make sure we don't do is Katrina still feeds Max. And he obviously is very capable of feeding himself right now. And her whole thing behind it was like, she didn't want to clean a mess up. She's like, I don't want to clean a mess up. I love being with him anyways and feeding him. And so she has fed him this whole time. And they actually say that has a lot to do with their speech development. So you, which you never think, right? Eating, how is feeding themselves? But
yeah,
it's,
that's a good question.
But it's it's the that part of the brain that they have to, you know, the proprioceptive part and
interesting
and their mouth being able to chew and figure it out and feed with their hand.
Wow, that's fascinating.
Yeah, actually helps speed up the development of their ability to communicate. So and talk. So that makes sense when you just read that study. That was something I just recently learned myself through trial and error on my end. It was that we should have, you know, forced Max to eat on his own earlier, dealt with the mess, because that probably would have progressed his speech.
Interesting. Well, I've read studies on and articles on geniuses. And do you know that most geniuses, most smart, really, really smart, highly successful people took longer to start speaking? Well, but then when they did, it was like,
I have a theory on that. I mean, and I like to think that, I mean, of course, every dad wants to think that his kid's a genius, right? Which you see, I can see Max's wheels turning. I see, and I saw it early on.
Oh, he's a very aware kid.
Yeah, and he understands, I can get him to do a lot of things. And so, and I was able to do that pretty early. So he just seems like he's waiting to say something, which is really funny. Yeah. So yeah, they predict that once he, like he's, we're getting ready, like I told you guys, the Montessori school or whatever, which has been really difficult to get him into, said that he will probably be there for a couple of weeks. I had a bunch of people DM me, too, after this conversation last time. And they said that, oh, my God, my son was going through the same thing. As soon as we put him in Montessori school, he got around other kids. Yeah. Like, all of a sudden, full-on sentences, like, two weeks later.
So. Yeah, the irony of a study like that, too, right? Because how much has public education cut physical activity, considering it not important?
Yeah. Yeah,
and so frustrating.
Physical activity and music, mm-hmm. which now we have so many studies showing that both of them make you better at math and, yep. and at vocabulary, the things that we think are so important. You need to move, and music is also an important thing that, you know, kids need. Yeah,
music
to learn.
Is mathematical. It's just it follows rhythm, it follows timing, like mm-hmm. everything is you know, predictable in that regard. And so if it gets into your subconscious and so, you know, it, and again, too, to be able to remember things like music's so, you know, crucial with that too. But yeah, I hate how like some of these programs get cut because they just deem them not quite as valuable when in fact, like if you add that into the mix, how much better, you know, your students of perform. Course.
You know, what's really cool right now is that, and it'll be interesting to hear Sal when this happens for you with Aurelius. I remember my two best friends who were a little bit ahead of me, right, with fatherhood. We're sharing that he hit this age and then it just feels like milestones and things like really start piling. Like, right? It's like 6 months, twilight zone. Then you have some big hurdles around month eight and a year where they're finally like sitting up and they're maybe walking by this time and stuff. But then then all of a sudden like just stuff starts, new stuff starts happening almost every day. And I remember them communicating that to me. And I feel like we're kind of going through that where like all of a sudden like new talking and babbling is happening right now. The new things he's interested in. So there's two things right now that just happened literally in the last 2 weeks that I think is hilarious or fun to watch is one, his fascination with bugs. So like now he thinks
these bugs are awesome.
Oh my God. He's not afraid to go pick a spider up or smash an ant. And like, you know, he's trying to grab bees. Like he's just, he's fascinated with bugs and not afraid to go grab them, squish them and do so that. So that's hilarious to watch him do that. And he has this fascination and he thinks it's hilarious to watch cat videos. So he just thinks it's so funny. If you guys look on YouTube and TikTok,
Are you kidding me? That's the most. There's more cat.
It's the most popular video.
Yeah, I didn't even know it was a thing. And it wasn't even me who figured this out. It was actually my best friend's wife when we were up in Truckee last, and she was on TikTok, which I don't even have, right? And she was showing him. I guess there's lots of viral cat videos or whatever like that. And he was just busting up laughing for like 5 minutes straight.
I love hearing little kids. Oh,
I know little laughs are the best, dude.
Dude, I got my son to like, because he giggles, he laughs. It's easy to get my son to laugh, but to get him to like belly laugh, mm-hmm. we bought this indoor swing. It's made for little babies, right? And he likes to swing. He likes it when I move him around quickly, so it's pretty funny. We put him in there. And he thought it was the funniest. I'll make sure I send the video to Andrew to put in. He was dying. He thought it was the funniest thing. Also, we're going through this thing right now where my son seems to have a bottomless pit when it comes to food. He just eat and eat and eat and eat and eat. And it's like Jessica and I are like, Like, what's it like? Are we feeding him too much? Like, because we'll feed him and I'll
be
like,
were you a big eater when you're his age?
No, terrible eater.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's what my mom says. You know, here's the deal, too. This is my mom talking. Remember my mom?
And Italian guidelines, is that basically?
Right.
He was a terrible eater. He was only eating six times a day.
Exactly.
He finished five bowls of pasta.
So I don't know. But, you know, I'll feed him. I'll be like, honey, I just gave him a whole avocado and a bunch of, you know, raspberries. And, he's upset because we're done. Like, what, you know? So we're feeding him and it's fun. And then, of course, my mom, oh my God, you know, the Italian grandma, I love feeding him. This is my favorite thing. I'm like, yeah, I know why, because she'll just eat whatever you get. And I'm like, we need to watch my mom when she feeds him, because she'll just
feed him to get him
yacked, dude. Watch out.
Oh, it's but now that he's eating more, of course, he's pooping more. So that's kind of annoying.
Yeah. You're at about that phase right now where the diaper explosions and stuff start happening.
Yeah, right, dude. Those start getting real interesting, those diapers. Yeah.
Speaking of kids, I wanted to ask you, Justin.
Yeah.
You said a couple episodes ago that you had some of your players use the Organifi protein because they couldn't have dairy. Are you getting feedback from them?
Yeah, actually, they love it because they've tried a bunch of other options out there and, you know, we're like, is there anything that like actually has a decent taste to it and still provides a good amount of protein? And so I turned them on to that. And what was cool about it too was because I've just been slowly introducing them to like certain things and sponsors that we have here on the show. It's been sort of spreading around the parents. And so they've all been kind of like sharing information with each other because to be honest, like we're totally unorganized right now as a new staff coming in, and still trying to kind of piece everything together. So communication with parents is pretty terrible right now. But, so I got in touch with Courtney got in touch with one of the parents because they're asking about what to feed the kids. Like nobody's telling us what to feed the kids. And she's like, well, you know, Justin was there and told them all, like, you know, broke down kind of what they should target and, you know, what were good foods, what were good sort of supplements and things that you might want to be interested in. And so I rewrote this whole list and I included that as in terms of anybody that has, you know, some kind of lactose intolerance or, you know, or vegan or whatnot. And so they've all been sharing it amongst each other. And so they're like going to the grocery store and they're buying Organifi, you know, from the store. And, so it's been cool to see that like now it's starting to be a focus amongst, you know, the parents groups.
Yeah. You know, what's exciting about that is you're working with like, you know, teenage boys, their bodies respond so fast to like, changing their diet and lifting weights.
Well, it's such a mystery for parents too. It's like, what do I feed this growing kid who's just in front of my eyes is changing every day? I know. You know,
I'm really curious to see how well they stick to anything. Like, I know I was really inconsistent as like a high school kid. I know you were a little more radical about working out, and so maybe you would have followed like a diet plan or whatever like that.
Uh-huh.
But kids just like so don't give a shit. I ate so terrible when I was younger like that. I was so interested in the sport and all the nuances of the sport, and I wanted to learn that.
Well, yeah, it's a small group right now. You know, like there's probably I would say like 10 like real.
Okay, so out of the whole, groups? So you have like 50 kids.
Yeah.
And only 10 are like...
10 are like, I'm tackling this.
That makes sense. Okay, that's what I figured. I figured you'd have like a small group that are like really like trying to figure out, okay, what should I eat and willing to actually go apply the knowledge they're getting from
you. And I totally factored that in because I was the same way. But then once I started introducing a protein, like a whey protein, and then I had sort of a system of like I'd take the shake first thing in the morning. And then, you know, like I was consistent with that. I started to see gains happen as a result of that. And so it's going to take some of these kids seeing the gains and then the other ones asking them what they're doing to really, you know, get that to spread. But I'm pretty sure it's going to happen.
That's cool.
You know, speaking of food, I didn't know this existed or not. I don't know if you guys know this, but you know, there's like on eBay, you can find like a Dorito chip for $15,000.
What does that have, like Jesus on it or something?
Yeah, I was going to say, is it shaped?
So that's a great guess. So that's exactly, I was like, what? So every once in a while, of course, like a, you know, things that are made in a factory and mass produced. Yeah, a random chip like this. The article is about this chip that was like almost like a 3D chip. You know, it was hollowed out in like a perfect shape or whatever like that. And so that's why it was on eBay for $15,000. Oh, wow. But then there's things like cinnamon rolls or things like that that end up looking like Mother Teresa. and then they're on there for like $25,000, $100,000 for food. that look like somebody famous or whatever, like that, the way that came out. Isn't that weird?
Yeah, that's a weird market.
Like, right?
I want to see someone.
Does it gain value, or do you know, you just sit on that as like, I am
so new to this, and I'm sure knowing our audience, we always have somebody who like knows more than we do about something we're talking about, right? Yeah. And so I'll get DMs after this. I'm completely new to it. I didn't even know it existed until I read this article, kind of started going down the rabbit hole.
Store it in some like vacuum sealed container, like display.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah.
You know, it would be baller. Just baller.
What?
Someone buys a $15,000 Dorito and eats it.
No, it's I'm sure.
In front of everybody.
Yeah. Here it is. That's how gangster I am. I don't care.
No, look it up, Doug, and see how I don't know how big this market is as far as like how many foods, but I thought it was pretty interesting. They ranged up to $100,000.
Wow. Well, while he's looking that up, a couple interesting factoids. I think I shared this before. You guys know that chicken nuggets only come in four shapes?
Yeah, you told us.
There's specific four shapes.
Oh, yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
And then here's the other thing. Fruit Loops cereal, right? It's got, you know,
By the way, that chicken nugget, that chicken nugget that chicken nugget. Let me try one more time. Fact.
Good job.
The chicken nugget fact. That's McDonald's, right? Not all chicken nuggets.
No. Yeah. McDonald's, there's like four shapes, and that's it. There's names for them.
Right.
Fruit Loops, right? You got your purple, your red, your green, same flavor. They're all the same flavor. They're not different.
Yeah. Wow.
And I swore to God.
Tricked us all.
I could have swore they were different flavors. That's how powerful
colors.
Now,
is that the same for things like Lifesavers and some of those?
No, Lifesavers is different.
And Skittles.
Skittles are different. Sure? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Come on, dude.
M&M's aren't, right?
They've tricked us
M&M's there. Are the same. Yeah. M&M's are exactly
M&M's
the same.
M&M's are the same. Yeah, are Skittles different?
Skittles are different. I 100%.
I don't know about that.
Oh, I know, dude. I like
that. But there's like two flavors.
No. There's green flavor.
Check it out.
Green flavor. There's yellow flavor.
Yellow flavor.
Yeah. You know what I was thinking about the Dorito? Like, what happens when your dog just eats it?
This article was talking about, I forgot what was it, cannoli or roll or that looked like the Mother Teresa or something. So like a shop had it for like 9 years, and they kept it on display. It was like a bakery shop or something like that, and people would look at it, and then it got stolen. Someone stole the cannoli that looked like Mother Teresa.
Stole the cannoli.
Yeah, it wasn't a cannoli, it was something else,
idiot's like, wow, this is the blessed Mother Teresa. I think I'll honor her by stealing it.
I think I need to steal it so I can make my way to heaven.
I feel like it's one of those things that because people say it, then it gets reinforced, and then you see it, right?
Yeah.
Like you've heard of that. Like, isn't that a phenomenon that happens? Like if we're looking at clouds, and then you go, do you see the unicorn jumping over or whatever? And then I'm like, oh, yeah.
Now I see it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's true.
Yeah,
that's
it's probably like that.
So this is something interesting I just read this morning. Did you guys know that a woman just set the all-time bench press record for women? And you guys want to guess what that number is? It's the heaviest bench press.
How terrible am I going to feel today about
my workout?
Sorry.
She's born a woman. I'm just clarifying.
Correct. Okay. It's a biological cisgender woman. World's heaviest female bench press of all time, she completed.
I'm going to
guess what the number is?
I'm going to go with 490 pounds.
What about you, Justin? This is going to be like the Price is Right again.
315.
605 pounds.
I was way off.
Yeah. Now, this is equipped. So, wow, in other words, she wore a bench shirt.
That's a strong lady.
So she was equipped, right?
Yeah.
Which can add, 100 pounds here, but doesn't matter. I don't care if it adds 150 pounds. That's insane.
Are those known to add 100 pounds?
Oh, yeah, dude.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Bench shirts and squat suits, if you know how to use them and you get the double ply crazy shit. You ever seen the guys walk out?
I know it's crazy, but 100 pounds is a lot.
Oh, people tell me more. People tell me.
That is crazy.
People tell me that at the high levels, when there's no like limits and you can wear whatever bench shirt you want, and the dude's walking out, wow, look at that. 600 pounds. No, it's 605. Is it Becca Swanson that did it again? Let me see what her name was.
Wow.
Rayanne.
How big is she?
Kuenor Miller. She's the one that set it.
She beat that record.
Yeah, Doug, I'll send you the link.
That was the old record. That was the old record right there. Yes. 600, and you said she did 605, right?
Yeah, 605. I'll send Doug the link.
Wasn't like Stevie Cohen up there for deadlift? She was pulling some serious weight.
Well, women typically will do pretty damn good pound for pound lower body, but bench press.
I haven't seen anything.
But you've seen when they put these shirts and stuff on. they walk out like this, or they'll need someone to.
Yeah, it normally takes two other big dudes to put on one of those. So I do know like how crazy they are, but I mean 100 pounds.
I think more. I know a guy. Wow. So I talked to a guy about this years ago. It was a power lifter, and we were having this whole discussion about it. There she is, 605. So she looks like she benched 605 too.
She does look like she benched 605.
Oh yeah. Definitely
capable.
So I was talking to a power lifter, and they said that some of these bench shirts are so insane that people will actually miss a lift. So they'll go to an event, they'll load the bar, they'll miss it because they can't get the bar to touch their chest. That's how tight. So they literally can't get the bar down to their chest.
Come on.
Yes.
That doesn't seem like so there's got to be somewhat of an asterisk there. I want to know how much they can actually bench without all the assistance.
Raw. You got to look up raw
records.
Yeah,
raw. Yeah.
And well, raw is the one.
Look that up, Doug. Let's see how much.
Look up world record heaviest women's bench press raw. I bet you there's a
huge discrepancy.
Yeah, I wonder if my number of 400 or something is more accurate for that.
Right.
For raw.
I would bet. I would bet it's in the 400 range.
Yeah.
Because it's a big, because if you look at the men's raw totals and
squat. All right, let's bet on that now. Okay. Yeah. So I'm going to say 450.
450?
Because last time I was way off.
Yeah. I'll agree with you. Let me see.
I'm 490. That's right. I'll have to stick with the number.
Let's see here. The women's equipped bench press now.
457?
The raw is 457.
Boom.
Wow. Now look at the difference. 450 to 600. Yeah, from that. But the men's are even bigger. If you look at the men's difference in raw versus equipped, it's even bigger.
Well, that's because of the number,
you can do 1,000 something equipped. You know?
Oh, yeah, dude. It's pretty wild.
Isn't the raw one up there? Isn't the raw bench press like 1,000 pounds?
Have you seen? No.
It's not?
No, I don't think it's 1,000 yet, raw. I mean, maybe it is.
8 or 9. Yeah.
Have you seen? So when you look at these bench pressing, like people that, you know, guys, girls that can just lift tremendous amounts of weight, and you look at their body, it's literally made to bench press.
Yeah.
They're like really big, round barrel body, short little arms.
Yeah. No, because Hapthor did like 1,000 deadlift and broke the record.
Totally
like,
different.
It. Yeah, it's a different.
Yeah, totally different. Let's see. Thing. Now, that we got to do raw, Doug. Yeah, look at the world bench press record raw. Yeah, that's all equipped. So let's see what we find here. 739.
Wow.
That is a huge
difference. Yeah.
Which is still like,
almost 300 pound difference.
Which is still insane. That's just still the most insane thing that I can think of. Pretty crazy. Justin, I want to ask you a question because you know you used to be a bartender, right?
Yeah, I was. I mean, it wasn't the greatest, but I did it for a few years.
Okay, is there a drink called a highball or a lowball or what are they called?
I think those are more referring to the actual cut, like the glasses. So a highball versus a lowball. A glass, so one of them is more focused on the bubbles, you know, sort of effervescence.
Really?
Drinks versus the low ball is mainly wider and shorter. So you're supposed to basically be able to smell like the essence of the drink, and you know, so it's more of like a presentation.
You see, MIIR's carrying that.
That's why I asked.
Yeah, yeah.
They have
I saw that in our commercial stuff. They sent over. They
it's,
sent
it's
over
a weighted
to
bottom
their,
too, so yeah, it won't sick. Spill easily.
Yeah, that's what I like about like rocks glasses and like low ball, like because they're weighted and you know, less likely to easily tip.
I like my cups like I like Justin.
This is
weighted bottom,
heavy bottom. we're more centered.
Well, I have to add that to the truckie bar, man. I like.
Oh yeah,
them.
Yeah we yeah. should get those up there.
No, 100%. I will. When I saw it over there, that was the first thing I said over to Jerry. I was like, make sure they send some over to us.
You know, it's funny. You don't realize, well, I mean, maybe some people realize this. The presentation of something completely changes the taste or the experience.
Oh, yeah, sure. No, it is. And I get like slightly annoyed if we go out or something and then there's certain garnishes and certain things that I would do to drinks that they didn't even come close to like including. I'm just like, it's missing so many ingredients.
Well, so like Jessica, right? If we go out to dinner and let's say she orders a glass of wine, she gets so mad when they fill the glass when the glass is mostly full of wine. She likes to have like this much wine in the glass, even if she has multiple glasses.
Oh, because she does the whole sniff.
She just doesn't like, she's like, it looks gross. I don't like it.
It looks gross.
Oh, she sent it back before. Can you put this in several glasses or give me one that's like only filled up to here?
Oh, really?
Because she doesn't like the presentation. It ruins the whole experience.
Interesting. On that note, Katrina's mom and dad used to, they roll around in their car. They have their they're particular about even the glass that it gets poured in. So they carry their own wine glasses at every restaurant they go to.
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Oh, yeah. Because
wine glasses
can get really expensive.
So you walk in with your own glass?
It has a, they have a, we actually have, for Christmas last year, they bought us, Katrina and I, and it's a black case about this big, and so obviously it's got all kinds of foam to protect it like that. You unzip it, and it's a travel case for wine glasses. So, yeah, they're like super particular about that. They go to a restaurant and stuff like that. They go pull their own wine glasses. They're like, don't pour. Because they, so the restaurants, they make like, they typically have, depending, most restaurants, their wine glasses are commercial grade. They're designed to be able to throw in a dishwasher, whatever like that. And I guess like really good wine glasses are way
more. See, I never got that. We definitely had like corkage fees and things, like people bring their own wines, which is fine. But yeah, I haven't seen that, you know, come in. Like, so that would have been interesting.
Yeah, that's Katrina's family. They're like, everybody in the family has their own travel. Well, we got ours like last Christmas or the Christmas before.
If you're really into it. Yeah, and they have like a winery and all. So
yeah. So they were,
well, I can't make fun of them.
They're serious about it.
I'll bring salt. I'll bring my own salt to a restaurant.
Yeah, you do that.
Yeah, I don't like their salt. Or I hate asking them for salt because then it takes forever and my food's sitting here. I'm not going to eat it without salt on it, dude. So I'll bring out my
pink salt. Oh, I know. They always forget it every time you ask. Yeah. Like, they never remember.
So here's something else that's cool. Justin, you'll appreciate this. So, and you know, I looked up the time because I didn't realize that Neanderthals and Denisovans, I think I'm saying it right, Denisovans.
Yeah.
So these are two different types or species of humans or
that existed at the same time, right?
That existed while, what are we called? Homo erectus?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. While Homo erectus existed, which is us, right? Us types of human, there were Neanderthals and there were also Denisovans. And then
sapiens.
There was. Huh?
Sapiens.
I think all of them are considered. I don't know.
Is that how?
Yeah, I think sapiens sort of umbrellas a lot of.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So anyway, there's.
I'm not too sure. Check me on that.
But there's other species as well. But those are the two best known, and they all coexisted like 50 to 100,000 years ago. So 100,000 years ago, you had humans like us, and then you had Neanderthals, and you had Denisovans, and of course they went extinct.
And there was the Hobbit, like the Hobbit. I forget the name of that.
Yes,
but that was another species.
Yeah, they're called something else. Oh, that's a Denisovan. Look at that. So,
yeah.
Isn't that interesting? So, and what's weird about that is, of course, they went extinct, and there's lots of speculation. Part of the speculation is that we killed them.
Yeah,
and probably ate them, or we outcompeted them because we were better hunters, or you know, better at creating tools that hunted, although they were also tool creators. So anyway, they went and found they analyzed their bones and really were able to figure out the blood types that they had. The theory was that they all had type O. So you guys know the different blood types, right?
Yeah.
A, B, B, right? Type O is considered the first blood type. It's the one that you can give all humans
universally, right?
This, yes.
Oh.
And that's the one that we all had lots long time ago. And then there were mutations that turned into different blood types. Well, believe it or not, Neanderthals also had A, B, and all that. They thought they would all be type O, but I guess it went further back than that.
Hmm.
So it didn't branch off until further back than 100,000 years ago is what they're theorizing with this, which is kind of interesting.
That is interesting.
Yeah. Hey, real quick, I hope you're enjoying this episode. Head over to myserenitykids.com. Now, this is a company that we're working with that makes healthy baby food. So they have grain-free snacks. They have meat pouches. They use bone broth. No preservatives. This is the best baby food you'll find anywhere. It's the only one that I give to my baby son. Adam, same thing. It's the only one he gives to his baby son. Head over to myserenitykids.com. Use the code MP20 for 20% off. All right, enjoy the rest of the show.
First question is from D. Seg Moen. How would you tweak anabolic and aesthetic to be an hour format?
So MAPS anabolic and MAPS aesthetic. So, you know, here's what's interesting about this. I obviously created MAPS anabolic. I still follow the program here and there. It doesn't take over an hour to do MAPS anabolic foundational workouts.
No,
it just
aesthetic
doesn't.
Does, but anabolic does not.
Aesthetic does. But MAPS anabolic doesn't. So if you're taking over an hour, either your rest periods are too long or I don't know what you're doing, it should not take over an hour. Now, MAPS aesthetic, I typically would do the workout in an hour and 15 minutes, hour and 20 minutes at most. I know Doug, same experience. It's just more volume. Now, if you don't have over an hour to do MAPS aesthetic workouts, you could just cut the sets out of the exercises for the areas of your body that you think need less work.
Well, there's other ways you could do this, or at least how I do it, because this happens to me sometimes. Sometimes I only have 40 minutes or 30 minutes and so, and I'm running through one of these programs, so what ends up happening? So if I'm short on time and I'm running MAPS Anabolic, and I talked about this the other day, I think, on the show, this is kind of how I'm training right now, is I'll cut in half, right? So it's only a three-day-a-week program. So what I'll end up doing is, you know, I'll do upper body one day, lower body the next day, upper body. But I'm following all the exercises in anabolic. I'm just turning it from a three-day-a-week to a six-day-a-week program and splitting it in half. So that's how I would mess with anabolic. Now, aesthetic.
You mean, okay, right.
Yeah. Now, that's how I would do anabolic. Now, aesthetic, because there's more days in the gym, it's a little bit longer, and then you have focus sessions. I would just add some, if I couldn't get to, I'd pick a muscle group or two, and I'd pull it out of the foundational day, and I would just add it to a focus day.
Oh, that's a great point.
Yeah. So
that's a really, really good point.
So you have a full, it's because the way aesthetic is designed, it's a full body routine, and then you have focus days every other day. So what I would just do is just say, oh, okay, I'm going to take my shoulder exercises and maybe my pushing exercises, shoulder, chest, and tries. I'm going to put on my focus day with my two or three focus exercises that I was going to do.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. I think that's great advice. And those are easily two of the most popular programs that we currently
have. I mean, one of the things we always try and communicate on the show is that, you know, we design these things as a foundation or as a kind of a generic blueprint for people to follow, but this is how you can modify this stuff. I mean,
yeah, your always best bet is to learn how to modify workouts for you, and this includes your body, your goals, your fitness, specific areas you want to focus on, and your schedule. Mm-hmm. And that was the idea. The idea was to give you the blueprint, and then you kind of move away or change it according to your individual needs. And that's always going to give you the best results anyway. Individualization of workouts is one of the best things.
Next question is from S Powers 28. Are deload weeks necessary?
I think easier workouts that allow your body to recover are necessary. Do I think it's necessary to schedule deload weeks? For some people, yes. For other people, no. Who would it be necessary for?
Competitors, right?
Yeah.
Athletic competitors or bodybuilders, I would think this would apply, you know, the majority of people towards in terms of scheduling it, you know, to sort of give you that break and refresh to then, you know, reprogram.
I never did this with most clients because most clients naturally have deload weeks.
Yeah.
Keeping a client consistent for 3 to 6 months and never missing a workout.
That was the hard thing.
That is extremely difficult. In fact, I probably failed 95% of the time. Yeah. The reality is they have vacation, they have busy lives, stuff happens for a week or whatever. So they naturally do it. The only clients or the only people that I ever had to do something like this with is the competitors. Somebody who actually could go years and not miss a workout. Mm-hmm. And those people tend to need these deload weeks, and it's highly beneficial for them. I let the other ones kind of naturally happen.
Yeah, a scheduled deload week is good if you're the kind of person that tends to, you know, oh, I know I'm supposed to go easier, but I'm going to go hard.
Yeah. Anyway,
like, this would be good for me, right? Because I know it's in my schedule. I have to do it, and it'll force me to do it because my tendency is to not do it. My tendency is to push probably too hard or too often. But for most people, I don't think scheduling a deload week is a big deal. But, you know, again, rephrasing the question, is it necessary to have workouts that give your body an opportunity to heal and recover? In other words, is it necessary to have easier workouts or lighter workouts? Oh, yeah. Yes, absolutely. And here's the thing. I think people believe that these easier workouts, or if you want to label them deload workouts, that's fine. I think people believe that deload workouts or easier workouts pause your progress. Like, okay, I'm not going to progress this week because I'm actually... Studies actually show that oftentimes progress happens in a deload week. So it's like they've been pushing, pushing, pushing. Then they go easier workouts, and then boom, they get all this you know, muscle growth or strength.
I think, the ideal situation is that you can intuitively pick up on the signs and signals your body is sending you and be able to back off, you know, and be able to weave in and out and undulate the intensity, the volume, whatever it is necessary to get you to fully recover so you could keep progressing.
Well, yeah. And we have to be careful here because it's like the question is necessary. And so I think we're addressing necessary, but valuable, yes. Mm-hmm. I think they can be very valuable, especially for someone like Sal. I mean, we recently shared a study on the show where, you had the two groups. One group trained consistently for 16 weeks, never took any days off, versus a group that every third week took a whole week off. And at the end of the study, the group that took the week off was had progressed just as much as the group that never took any days off. Mm-hmm. So there's definitely tremendous value. If you can do less work and get the same results as somebody who's doing more work, then there's obviously there's value there. Mm-hmm. That's what that study points out. So, but I think our point is saying that most people naturally take days off, naturally deload because of just regular life things that happen. Now, if you're the hardcore, super consistent and high volume training type of person, then I think they're extremely valuable. And according to that study, you could get away with every month taking a few days or a week off of training, mm-hmm. and it would be beneficial.
Now, for you guys have signs that you look out for yourselves where you say, okay, this is happening, I need to go easy on my workouts?
For me, I can sense whether or not like I'm putting too much pressure in certain joints and like, So like I have pain right now is specifically that I'm dealing with my shoulder hips. And so I'm definitely still going through the movements, but with a lot less intensity and, you know, bring the volume down. But I plan on kind of weaving in and out of that so that way I can allow them to recover.
Is that from your workout video?
What happened? For the shoulder, for sure. Yeah. I definitely pushed it.
Because you pushed that 120 something pound kettlebell.
Yeah, that's the problem.
That's
you're talking me up a bit. I didn't want to like do just like my regular workout. So that was totally a performance workout, so I paid for that a bit because it was outside of my normal intensity range. But now it's just a matter of getting myself back to where I feel like my body's like at its optimal form.
Yeah, I think for me, I all the time now because of you assholes. I was a much better.
He blames everything.
It is your fault. It's 100% your guys' fault because before you guys, I never even, like I said, I never trained singles and doubles and triples. And I mean, I never cared about my max, PR, none of that stuff ever. Yeah. I was so anti that. I used to talk shit about that all the time. It's not necessary. You can build an incredible, and because you know me.
Say when you're naked in the bedroom, she doesn't ask you how much you can bench.
That's right. Yeah. You know, it was all show, no go. I wasn't about performance. I wasn't about how much I bench. I wanted to look good. And I was very sure of that's what my goal was and what I wanted to accomplish. And it wasn't necessary for me to push the boundaries as far as weight. Now we started hanging out together and now I'm paying attention to how much do I bench press, how much do I squat, how much do I deadlift, and now my my hips, my elbow, my shoulder always are talking to me, because what ends up happening is I get in a little bit of a rhythm and I want to see what I can push and what I can do, and then my body reminds me that you should be training more.
I'll
like
give
this
you some of those so, some of those advanced age
stretching
vitamins.
Your capacity Adam
help,
that's
yeah,
all
help, yeah, help your yeah. help So your
it's true. I mean, I'm teasing about blaming it on you guys, but I really didn't suffer from a lot of that stuff until that is the one challenge with
you push performance hard too often for sure.
Yeah, it's hard though because it is a a double-edged sword, right? Because there are tremendous benefits I've got since I've trained that way too. Though, like one of the things I love that I notice about my body today than just 5-6 years ago is because I've gotten so strong in some of these big compound lifts, man, if I make sure I hit overhead press, squat, deadlift, and bench like once a week, it actually maintains my physique. I don't have as aesthetic as the competitive Adam does or whatever like that, but I definitely can maintain where a AMPM worker will think that I look strong and fit.
That's
what I'm saying?
Yeah. I remember you saying that.
That feels good. Yeah.
You look strong.
Strong.
Wow, you're like a jacked guy.
Next question is from Chai Latte. How can I tell if I lack mobility or if it's just my anatomical limitations?
Right. 9 out of 10 times, it's a mobility issue. So yeah. 9 out of 10 times, you lack the strength, the control, and the stability. 1 out of 10 times, there's something wrong with your bones or your joints that's causing the issue. Anatomically speaking, not like you had an injury in your joint, but rather the joint is constructed in a way to where it's a limiting factor. And how do you know the difference? Well, it's like, imagine going into a deep squat and you feel literally a block. Bones, boom, that's it. Like almost like extending my elbow. I can't extend my elbow any further. That's not a mobility issue. My joint just won't extend any further. Mm-hmm. So that's what that feels like. Now going to the bottom of a squat and feeling tight, and oh, my hip flexor, or oh, I can't go any further because my heels rise, or I feel, that's usually mobility. And again, I say 9 out of 10 times because ever since, you see this now in social media posts where you see these like, you know, these anatomy experts will post mm-hmm. a picture of a hip joint and will show, see, this person can't squat this deep or they need to have a wider stance because the way that the femur fits in the... Mm-hmm. So now you have all these people who have poor mobility who now have a wonderful excuse. And they're like, oh, yeah. This is why I don't lift totally. That way. It's because my bones and I can't change my bones. No, 9 out of 10 times... You just don't have the strength.
Well, then you add in, and to defend the guys that and girls that slam all the mobility people is now, okay, people are aware that there's this mobility thing that a lot of people may or may not be, should be doing. And now everybody's jumping on the bandwagon of trying to sell people this idea. I think a really cool way to test this is actually the discrepancy from left to right. So an easy way to tell it has nothing to do with your morphology, right? So your structure, and to see if there is a mobility issue is the discrepancy from left to right. If you do your hips in a 90-90, for example, and the left to right looks exactly the same as far as internal and external rotation, that might be your range of motion mm-hmm. for your hips. Now everybody can probably extend their capacity a little bit, give or take.
Also, look at passive mobility, yeah. right? Someone could lift your leg and show you, oh no, it moves that way. You just right. can't do it yourself.
Right, right. And so looking at left to right, and rarely ever have I ever seen this in my own body or any clients, do they always match completely. And mm-hmm. so if you see that, you know, this shoulder has no problem getting here, but then when I go to do this one, that's all I got. There's definitely a mobility issue there. Mm-hmm. There's no, because you definitely don't have a discrepancy in your morphology from left yeah. to right like that. Yeah. It's hard to argue, you know, oh, your feet externally rotate because that's the way your pelvis is, and how am I going to debate that? But if I get you down in a 90-90 and I go to show that your left heel, you can lift up off the ground 6 inches, and then the other one, you can't even budge. That's very obvious to me as a coach. There's a mobility issue in that hip. Mm-hmm. And we probably can improve both, and there's a good chance there's an issue in both. But that's one of the best ways to be sure of that.
Yeah, I have somewhat of a challenge, you know, to that mentality in terms of, like, I see a lot of coaches out there that put, like, you know, if you have this kind of setup, you know, with your femur and your hips, and you should probably go into this stance, and, you know, and so immediately sort of eliminating just the movement in general, whereas I would be more comfortable with having multiple stances where we can see where those, you know, ranges lie, and then try to get subtle improvements on each one of them and not just eliminate mm-hmm. them unless it's really causing you some kind of, like, you know, dysfunction where you're going to have, you know, chronic pain from it, or, you know, like some kind of, like, injury is as a result because it's such a bad angle. But, you know, in my experience, I haven't found that to be the case.
Yeah. Okay. So here's the problem. The problem is that we consider things like squats, overhead presses, rows, you know, horizontal presses. We don't consider them foundational human movements. So oftentimes people will say that their lack of mobility is an anatomical issue. But if I change the words, but not the conversation, I think this starts to make a little bit more sense. So let's say somebody was walking funny. You see someone walking funny down the street. Most doctors, most movement specialists, most trainers, most fitness people would say there's a muscle issue going on there. There's a mobility issue going on there. There's the firing pattern is wrong. Most people wouldn't say there's an anatomical problem. Now, are there anatomical issues that can cause people to walk in ways that are dysfunctional? Yes. Are they common? No. They're rare. Far more common if somebody's walking wrong, just to use a word that, you know, just off the top of my head, if they're walking in a dysfunctional way, it's because their recruitment patterns aren't ideal or they have mobility issues that are not working for them. Same thing applies to squatting. Squatting is a fundamental human movement. Pushing your arms overhead, fundamental human movement. Rowing, fundamental human movement. So if you can't do those things with a good, comfortable full range of motion, chances are very high. It has nothing to do with your bones or things that you can't work on. It has probably has everything to do with the fact that you lack the strength, the stability, the flexibility, the mobility. These are all things that you can work on. So again, 9 out of 10 times, I'll stand by that. It's not anatomy.
Next question is from Stacy Lynn, 22. Tips on how to stay consistent when you work 10-hour days.
Oh, yeah. You know, here's what I found. So I've been working out for a long time. I'm very consistent with my workouts. In an ideal world, I would work out at probably 2 p.m. in the day. It's when I feel the strongest. It would be, you know, a couple hours after lunch. My pre-workout would hit real good. I'd have a great workout. I used to do this when I owned my studio. And, you know, clients would typically come in the morning and then in the evening, so I'd have that break. And then, you know, things changed. We do this. I have more kids now, more responsibility. So I have to schedule my workout first thing in the morning. If I start my day with a workout, I'm consistent. If I try to end my day with a workout or I try to inject my workout in the middle of my day, consistency becomes far more challenging. Now, I've seen this with clients, and I've seen this with members. I've managed many, many, many gyms with lots of traffic. In other words, lots of members coming in. And I'll tell you what, there is a huge difference between the morning crowd and the afternoon or evening crowd. The afternoon or evening crowd is transient, often new people all the time. You go in at 6 a.m., even in a big box gym, not a hardcore gym, you go in at 6 a.m., do it for a week, and I guarantee you'll see the same crowd almost every single time. So that's my best advice. My best advice to someone is if you want to be consistent, one, and I know this sucks for some people, they don't want to wake up early, whatever, but I tell you, this is a great strategy. Start your day with your workouts. You're far more likely to be consistent.
Yeah. I can get down with that.
Yeah, I was just going to think, like, I wonder what they do for a job, because I was just thinking about this the other day, because one of my friends works in construction and has a very intensive, like, manual, like, his body is very physical job, let's say. And so works really long hours, but also was trying to get in lifts like at the end of the night, and was focusing on things that he was already using quite substantially in his job, to the point where I wasn't having any progress with like shoulder, with, you know, like lots of different like muscle groups he was focusing on. And, you know, in terms of like getting the overall volume was really high, he's in pretty good shape just literally from his job. And so to kind of figure out a way to create a better workout, you know, focused on maybe some muscle groups he's neglecting more, and also like more of a restorative type of, you know, workout was something that he actually started to then unlock, you know, what he was seeking in terms of his goal, physique, and all that kind of stuff.
I have another one for you. I agree with Sally, even though I'm not a morning person and I don't work out in the morning, but I do agree with that because that's very true. The most consistent people in the gym are always the 5 a.m. crowd. But I have something to ask you guys that I think is interesting that I learned about myself, and I've alluded to this on the show before. I don't know if I've pointed this fact out before, but you know, the most important day, if we're talking about consistency, right? So if for my routine, if I'm going to be consistent with my training, you know what the most important day is that I train?
Is it Monday, start of the week?
Sunday.
Oh.
And the reason why it's Sunday is because that's my last day off. Mm. And I'm about to start the work week. And if I'm already starting my work week and I got a good workout in the day before, no excuses, right? Because work hits. 10-hour days happen. Shit can hit the fan, right? Whatever. But Sunday I'm off and technically I don't have to do anything. I learned about 10 years ago when I scheduled my training, and that this includes meal planning, everything. If I want to be consistent, if I schedule day one of whatever the plan is on Sunday when my day is up, which is typically a day off for me. So this would change if you have like Monday, Tuesday off or whatever that. Mm-hmm. So it's your last day off before you start the work week.
getting that workout in, making the meals, what all that is done, it sets the tone for what the week is going to be. If I miss Sunday's workout and I come in, it takes extra discipline for me to make sure I train on Monday. But if I had already lifted on Sunday, I already feel like I got good momentum going into the week, and I don't want to stop that momentum. And I have found that I've had way more success. And so I used to have a lot of success with clients getting them to actually plan training on the weekends, because what we typically do is work all week. We try and train and diet and do it well. And then the weekends, everyone goes, I'm off of everything. I'm off of work. I'm off of eating well. Yeah. I'm off of training. Where I would go, okay, I'm not actually going to think about what days I'm going to train during the week. I'm not going to think about my diet so much in the week. I'm going to crush Saturday and Sunday. I'm going to make sure I have a successful day of eating and a successful day of training on the weekend. And what I have found is I actually go into the week with way more consistency than if I had not done that over the weekend.
Yeah, I think it's important. So that's one good point about that, Adam, is you have to kind of figure yourself out and what gets you going and what gets you consistent. You know, to the you mentioned your friend that's in construction. I had a cousin who worked in construction. This was years ago, and he still does, but this particular instance was years ago. I managed the 24-hour up in Sunnyvale, and he wanted to start working out, wanted to get consistent, used to play football in high school. And he's like, man, it sucks because when I'm done with work around 3 or 4 p.m., I think 4 p.m., I think he was done with his job. He's like, I'm exhausted, man. Yeah. I'm moving sheetrock and roofing and doing all this stuff. He's like, I'm dead tired, and I'll drink a cup of coffee or drink a Red Bull, come in and try and work out, and I'm just not good. And I'm like, listen, dude, try working out first thing in the morning. And he goes, I would literally have to work out at 4 a.m. to make that happen. And I said, try it out and just see how consistent you are. I know you got to wake up earlier and do the whole thing. You just got to go to bed earlier. And he did it, and he was extremely consistent. And he said, you're right. He goes, kind of sucks. I got to wake up earlier. Yeah. I got to go to bed earlier. He goes, but when I start my day with my workout, first of all, I feel better during work.
Yeah, you get more energized at work.
And he goes, and I never miss a workout because that's just the beginning of my day. It's the first thing on your list. When you move it down the list, it's like, I promise you, if I didn't work out first thing in the morning, it would be so hard to be consistent. So, yeah. Great advice all the way around. Look, if you like our information, if you like our content, you will love mindpumpfree.com. Head over there. Check out all of our free guides that can help you to do anything fitness related, including fat loss, muscle gain, mobility. We even have guides for personal trainers. Again, it's mindpumpfree.com. You can also find all of us on Instagram. So you can find Justin at mindpumpjustin, me at mindpumpsal, and Adam at mindpumpadam.